Nevada City. And they set up a government in the fort there first. And what happened in the early 1600s was that the Iroquois people, they were also referred to as the Confederacy. And they were more aggressive people. I'm saying this by myself, I'm not, but they appeared to me, in terms of everything that I've seen and read, is that they were more like the Roman Empire of the indigenous groups. And they were coming this way. They already had the Ohio Valley, they had gone as far west as Montana, they were in Canada, their area was growing big. And they did it, if they couldn't do it through trade, they did it through war. And at that time, the Wabanaki Confederacy, the Abenakis, who were living here in Vermont, Nadakana, got Samuel D. Champlain's attention and said, look, it was just 2 years ago, in the earlier 1600s, that your French outposts in the Great Lakes were attacked and burned by the Iroquois. And guess what? They're coming this way. It would be in your interest to be with us and protecting our homeland. And you know, you have your reasons also for being an ally. And I think it's going to take all of us in order to stop them. We didn't want to give up our homeland. Things that happened in those days were, the way they used to deal with prisoners were quite different. Some people, prisoners were killed outright because of their rank as warriors. Some of them thought they were scouts and had information. But mostly, they were just common people who were living and surviving seasonally. They were traded as slaves among themselves, as property. That was at times of war. We had agreements with the nations around us, and that didn't happen. The Innu and the Cree we were very friendly with. The Mohawks, to a degree, we were friendly with. To those south of us, we had good relations. So that was one reason why the Wabanaki Confederacy was being able to expand to the areas that it did. Because good relations usually bring good allies. Now, sometimes deer herds would be low in northern New York for whatever reason, and the Mohawks needed meat. So we would offer them at times back and forth across the lake into our lands and into their land. And sometimes those agreements upheld, sometimes they didn't. In any case, that's when Samuel D. Champlain came down in 1609, allies with the Abenaki. They went down the lake, and they went to just south of Ticonderoga today, and that's where the Iroquois showed up. What was different at that time was that the French brought the first firing weapons, the arquebus, which was a prelude to the flintlock and modern weapons today. Nobody had seen any of that before. So it was, you know, when a flash of gunpowder went off, it was magical. We didn't realize what it was or that. They set up their guns. They killed an Iroquois, a Mohawk chief outright. And everybody was like, the battle stopped. Everybody's looking, and they were amazed. And then the battle started up fiercely again. That was a big turning point. It was, I liken it to us dropping the atom bomb in World War II. It changed everything. Everybody wanted a flintlock after that. And so the way people thought about things, they thought about warfare, started to change.